Hi, sorry, okay, hi, I'm Bush Minahan, and I know that you are a PhD candidate in the Faculty of Education at Memphis. And you, okay, I had you in the future. Yeah. So he is a PhD candidate, and he's also actively involved in the collaboration between Monash University into studies and countering radicalizations. Radicalization. So he's a really cool guy. Sorry about that. Have fun. I'll flip the questions. Oh, sorry. And the guy leading the panel is my good friend Mark Mustafa, who has a PhD. He's at Deakin University. He's a PhD candidate with Penny Mansouri, and he's a great guy. And looking forward to it. Sit down.
Selamat siang. So in every human it's dangerous time because after lines normally people sleep. So this why we have to sing song to begin sessions. Let's just get it up. I hope that nobody is sleeping in the room. Thanks, Anna, for the introduction. I think we have all of them over here. All of them will look at the topic. But Greg will look at the issue of youth radicalism, and then Ibu Bina will look at the issue of youth radicalism, and then Pak Agus will look at the issue of Islamic school and radicalism. So, Pak Greg, because I think he's still this morning, so he asked me to give his chance at the last. That's fine. I think I'll give each of these panelists 5 minutes before we have a discussion later on. So the format will be a talk show, will be interactive, so I'll give them some questions after 5 minute presentations. And then for like 3:30 or 45 minutes, and after that, all of you can participate. You have to have some questions and comments about that. So I'm going to start with Mas Agus, the 5 minute presentation, and then after that, Ibu Dina, and then Patrick. Yeah. Mas Agus have some slides, so maybe Mas Agus or anybody.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
All right, thank you very much. So my name is Agus Mukhtar. I am the subject of hiring here, so don't expect too much from me. But while doing my PhD, I'm a member of a collaborative research project on mitigating against extremism between Malaysia University and then Malaysia University and then University of Industry developing research design that we are going to do something for the next week. All right. Talking about terrorism in Indonesia, actually, I like to use the word extremism because if we talk about education and terrorism, it's not a big concern right now. But I prefer to use the word extremism because we need to differentiate between the word terrorism and extremism. So every terrorist is an extremist. But an extremist doesn't necessarily be terrorist. So we just need to be accurate. So what it means by extremism is that someone who calls value that that's the best value and not tolerating another value as their paradigm. And if we look at these three guys, they are both young people, just graduated from senior high school and then all of them live atrocity in the society. So what's wrong with education in Indonesia? Why is that kind of young people with such kind of atrocity in this society? So If we look at the Islamic education in Indonesia, so it's in total Indonesia has around 193,000 schools in Indonesia, and Islamic school in Indonesia we have 49,337 Islamic schools. That's a lot. In Australia, I think has like around 9,000 something schools. So it's completely Indonesia. 92% of Islamic school in Indonesia is private. So what it means by this is that education in Islamic education and education in general in Indonesia is market. And it's not difficult to build the school because I did build one school when I was in undergrad. Me and my friend, we built a school and then we have money around 10,000 and then we ran the building and then we built school. So if you have 10,000 money, can build school. So the dangerous threat of this education as a market. So every ideology can be transmitted into school. So a lot of extreme school in Indonesia, we use the government. So if you look at the national curriculum, same school in Turkey, for example, they have same national curriculum, but they can sneak around the system, like in what we call in education, what we call by hidden curriculum. So we use hidden curriculum to transmit the extreme ideologies. So like this. This is a very quote from the. So something like this is happening in our school. Right. The next concern, apart from the leading place for extremism, now we also have the concern of technology, right? So recently said the VR Associate found that there are 88 million internet users in Indonesia. And then 79 of them are active in social media. And then 54% are young, which whom they cannot differentiate fake news, like all of us now. You know, like in Indonesia, we share and then we share fake news. Like these young people do not know which one is the related, which one is true news, and then which one is fake. There is a concern that the big media is now being attacked by this technology. And then the concern is that, so in 2014, UNESCO, along with Harvard University, they conducted the research internet using in Indonesia, and then most of them, more than 90% of them, they are unsupervised, be it by their teacher and also by so unsupervised internet users, they are being so they often like pornography, they often something like that. So it's happening. And then what happened, like if the young people in Indonesia access like that kind of website, and it's increasing in terms of the level of extremism among the Indonesia. So we all know that there is a phrase of mukidi, right? Muriti digital. Mukidi is muriti digital. They don't know. Who is the leader? So they learn Islam. They learn Islam.
One minute.
So I think I will leave it there. So I would say instead of the actual thing about education and extremism in the media, we can discuss that.
Okay, for the Council of Institute Education, I'll come to that after the other panel stop and give us some general idea of that issue. So, would you not give us 5 minutes? I'd like to show you.
Thank you for the opportunity. First of all, I would like to thank my colleague, Professor Daniel Shah Hussein, who is also the chairman of the Nahdlatul Ulama chapter of Australia and New Zealand. He's a long friend of mine, long time friend of mine. And why for me this is quite historic, because I'm probably the only not member of Nahdlatul Ulama. Even Patrick probably has membership, yeah?
not the only one. We have a lot of friends from
Yeah. Anyway, but I to be honest, I'm you know very very happy when I heard that I get invited, and also you know to be able to meet friends here, and also to talk about what it is with women in Indonesia, because most often when we are talking about Indonesian politics, talking about Islam in Indonesia, the issue of women are always marginalized. And in Indonesia, but also everywhere. I was in London recently, and then because I was the only one who is given the opportunity to talk about gender in Indonesia and in relation to Islam. So probably I will start with my academic works. I've been working on researching Indonesian women, in particular with my PhD, looking at the role of women's organization in Aceh. Why Aceh? Because Aceh is the only province in Indonesia that has been implementing Sharia law. And of course, the issue of women has always been the major setbacks in the implementation of the Sharia law, women being attacked for not wearing headscarf, women being attacked for wearing trousers and what they call like showing your body shapes. And you know, I don't know how many of you have been in Aceh, but Aceh is in the coastal area, most of the area. And then when you walk in the beach, of course, you know how big your dress is. Whenever there's strong wind, your body shape will be there. Can't blame women. And then. And then my research on women and Indonesian politics continues since then. And quite interesting, because if any of you are familiar with the Western world, and most often the issue is women wearing headscarf is the perfect example of women being subordinated, women being oppressed. My research in Aceh, for example, and also in other parts of Indonesia, and also many other major Muslim feminist groups have already talked about this, that women actually also find liberation by wearing headscarf. There are women who, voluntarily choose to cover. It's not because they're being told that it's what Islam says, but that's something that they choose, that they it's good for her. And this is something that also occurred in Indonesia. And we are very fortunate to have Muslim women leaders coming from both NU and Muhammadiyah. Professor Greg Barton mentioned this morning that, when talking about democracy, civil society, it's not just about men, but it's also about women, because it's women who are graduated from Pesantren, who are very familiar with fiqh, who are very familiar with all Islamic thought. And they came out and said that this is something that the government and the state must do for women, because women are equal. It is granted in the Quran, and there are lots of hadith that are also. So Professor Musdan Mulia, Ibu Liz Marcus, and then even Gusdur's wife, Ibu Sinta Nuria, are all these female Muslim leaders who come forward and then say this is what Islam says about women. And of course, with Gusdur himself, I remember in the early 1980s, for example, he established the first organization, civil society organization, that particularly looked at the women's reproductive rights, the PTIF. That was the first major organization from within Muslim community that talks about women's reproductive rights. That was very controversial, but I think that was the opening of the conversation in the public, that women have the right to say something in regards to the private and also public life. And then it continues until now on. There are lots of organizations, women's organizations affiliated with ulama, and all of this we should be grateful with what Gusdur have already pioneered with the thing of with the thought of equality and also promotion of justice. That's also something that I always mention in my work. And of course, and then Muhammadiyah also continued that path, trying to also promote the rights of women, not only in private and public, but also in their representation in politics and also in a much broader public life. One more minute. But I guess in the last 60 seconds, I would like to say that the issue of women in Indonesia is not merely about Islam or the role of Islam, but it's needed to also look at of Indonesia's long history of struggle with colonialism and also with the current capitalism and also all this globalization. So it is, against the Western feminist who says that this is merely about Islam, well, actually, let's look back and then what's happened, because in the 17th century, there are already female leaders, female kings in West Sumatra and also in Aceh, for example, and also in the 19th century, the first Islamic schools for Muslim women established in West Sumatra. Asia. So I guess again, but of course it's politics, and politics everywhere is always men who get to make a decision. And so my argument is always that we need more women in that decision-making space in both NU and Muhammadiyah, and also in the parliament, for example. We still lack that representation. But recently, a group of Indonesian civil society activists trying to put all women's names in Wikipedia. So if you're looking for female speakers in your event, you can look at that, and then you can find lots of these women's names, females activists and female academics. So that's, I think, really try to promote equality and access for women in Indonesia.
Thank you, Lina. On the issue of women. Now we are going to hear about the issue of you. So we have heard the issue of Sunday schooling, and now because we know that most of the actors of social problems are youth. So we want to hear more about you and from Greg.
Okay, thanks. 5 minutes. Okay, I'll just outline some conceptual points. We have time for discussions, but conceptual points will help us. Let me ask a question first of all. How many of you have watched Norman Ismail's Jihad Selfie? Okay, so you're familiar with the film, part of the film. One guy that he follows from Aceh. What stops him following his friends to go off and join ISIS? Family, and in particular? His mom, yeah. And you can see how powerful a mother's love can be. And mother and father are good examples. I think father plays a very important role for young men. And the love of his mother kept him back. Violent extremism, youth becoming involved in violent extremism, is it's largely a social process. They get drawn in by peer networks, by friends their own age, exploited by people who are a little bit older or very much older. In many cases, we see this in Australia, particularly in Western context, the process of recruitment, the process of false friendship, like if somebody is approaching somebody for a relationship, relationships, that the young person is exploited by the promise of friendship. So false, it's always referred to as grooming. So the person pretends to be your friend, but actually they just want to get something out of you. It can happen very much in social media and online. Cause the problem becomes the conduit to the problem. But let me back up for a minute and try and give some definitions for our discussion. So, we're talking about radicalism here. and we talked about extremism. So what do we mean by these terms? Perhaps it's useful to think of a spectrum of ideas. The ideas themselves are part of what is going on. It's the social process that determines where we end up. So if you grow up in a good home, Ahmadiyya, Endo, good role models, good teaching, chances are you'll be safe. Very, very few Indonesians have joined ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra. Very small percentage, because they're embedded in a safe context. Those that do join are often somewhat vulnerable. Many they're traveling abroad, studying, as we saw in North English film, and they get led astray by friendship. So the ideas become important at that stage, because the ideas are used to through friendship networks to persuade them. So Gusdur, as we heard, could be sometimes described as being a progressive thinker. Gusdur, Johan Effendi, Chuck Noor. But of course, the people they are influencing, most of NU is not progressive. NU is moderate. Moderate, sometimes socially conservative. Many NU, many Muhammadiyah are socially conservative. Conservative is not a problem. But of course, there are issues that need to be addressed, women's equality, human rights, etc., where enlightened progressive leadership can influence sort of mainstream moderate, even the socially conservative, to slowly change things. It's important to understand that having strong ideas, including strong, in this case, strong religious ideas, as a young Muslim, strong ideas are not the problem. The problem is when we become persuaded that the use of violence is justified, that the ends justify the means. And young people by nature, we talked before about Anak Barugude, as if it's kind of a bad thing, but actually the whole idea of being remaja, of being youth, is young people are full of idealism. They want the world to be a better place. They look at Syria and they say, it's almost 6 years of civil war in Syria. We see terrible things happening in the siege of Aleppo. Somebody should do something. Saying, why do bad things happen to good people? Somebody should do something. Take action. The question is, what action do they take? If they're collecting money for orphans and doing practical work, it's a good thing. If they mistakenly think that joining Jabhat al-Nusra or ISIS is a good thing, and then they misunderstand what's actually happening on the ground. Maybe they go there and they have regrets when they come back, as we saw in the previous film. But in conclusion, the point is that radical ideas or extreme ideas or strong ideas as a young person are normal. But we need society, community to channel that idealism in ways that are constructive, not destructive. So Gusdur said when Suharto was under pressure, we had an opportunity to push for reformasi, for democracy, everyone's blessing, but in a non-violent way. Compassion and said, no, now is the time for a revolution. Dangerous things. And the sort of radicalism that we're concerned about is revolutionary radicalism that uses violence, or in terms of extremism, violent extremism. And we're not criticizing young people's enthusiasm, we're trying to help them understand without violent extremism, without the point of attempting political revolution. One last point, 2nd of December in Jakarta, 212 movements, half a million, maybe three quarters of a million people protesting. Many have extreme ideas. Most of them are not. It was a very peaceful day. I wasn't there, but I was there on Tuesday, and people told me that the previous Friday at all. So the extremism is of a concern, but fortunately it's not violent. But there is a reason to be concerned about any time anyone is pushing extremist ideas in a way that's intolerant to the point of encouraging hatred. Just recently, the news this week, Geert Wilders was charged. He was charged because he was addressing a group of people campaigning for his party, and he said, are you happy with Muslims in the Netherlands? Are you happy with Moroccans coming? Are there too many? Should there be less? And they said, yes, 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 right? He was stirring the crowd. And then he said, okay, we'll fix it. We'll make it happen, but there's less Muslims. He was charged in this incitement to hatred, but incitement to sectarianism. And the Dutch court was correct. They said he has the right to freedom of speech, but in the liberal democracy of the Netherlands, you don't have a right to incite sectarian sentiment or hatred. Others should be charged by the Indonesian state. I think it's wrong that a narrow understanding of blasphemy is applied against Ahok, and yet those calling for hatred and sectarianism are not being challenged. We'll come back to that in the discussion. But the, there is a link between that kind of, that's not, Habib Rizieq is not a terrorist. Front of the belly Islam is not terrorism. But it's the beginning of a problem that somebody who is young, influenced by their friends, start with those ideas and that association, and it makes it easy they can take it into a dangerous place. Thanks, Patrick. I think we will have to look at it. We'll ask more. So I'll come back to the all of the speaker. Private school in Indonesia, that is like 92%.
Yeah.
So if you can learn more, how many percent that has learned to be Islamic school of thought, something like that. And then how the idea of radicalism is rooted in the school.
Right. As far as I know, there is no telling about the number of school, but there is a recent research conducted by Sakara Foundation and then by Laki from Win Jakarta, the University of Islamic University of Jakarta, stating that there is an increasing of intolerance. The research is stating that more than 80% of teachers agree with the application of Islamic Sharia in Indonesia. Right. So that kind of number is to me is really scary. Well, actually, the problem with Islamic education in Indonesia, with the education and the Islamic education in particular in Indonesia, is that the government cannot control and cannot manage as to how the process of education is conducted. So oftentimes the private of the, for example, Islamic education teacher is imposed to their student. So the perspective of Islamic education teacher are being distributed to their student. What is that? Teaching their student about the concept of unity and diversity. So, like, for example, if an Islamic education, I'm from, for example, GI, my Islamic network, so I can easily teach the concept of Islamic education, or the concept of GI, and then there is an increasing Islamic, for example, the Islamic Tafatul, the school that is initiated by some activists from Italy. If we study their value inside their school, because they principles from Hassan al-Bara, like the housing theory, it shouldn't be teached. In my opinion, if I were in the government, I would prohibit that thing, because how come in Indonesia we teach whole school thinking that Islamic teaching, that should apply Islamic principle in our society, that kind of things.
Okay, you talk about the role of teacher, you said that more than
80%
tend to be what's about it. I heard that like in the last the school for the example there is process there is member to the mission of NU whether who should be the office, who should be the pledges delegations at the school. So not only DK but also somehow different negotiations from NU or from something like that. Just to make sure that they involve the position after education at the school. Do you follow this?
So what was your point? Like,
but there is also not measures that play you to
to simply deliver the religious education at my school. Because if you remember in Indonesia, there is Osis, there is like Hipnum, and then they always struggle. I mean, in the last 10 years, for example, I heard that there is always struggle in Jakarta, probably. So, what do you think about these tensions?
It's really complicated to, you know, to respond back to that, because, but the thing is that you know, like in terms of the education in Indonesia, we have too many problems. Like the educational system itself is what we call the flavor of schooling. The education in Indonesia doesn't allow students to be critical, right? So critical thinking is the place of critical thinking in Indonesia. And the scary thing is that the recent research on reading literacy in Indonesia stating that in Indonesia, only one people who read Chinese among 1,000. Can you imagine? So the level of literacy of education people is 0.001. Really scary, like what Bahasa mentioned before. When we are in this difficult position, you know, struggle between Islam and Islamism, something like that. So education we have a lot of potential to be studied and then.
Okay, thanks Mas Adi. Question for the Indonesia. You mentioned a lot of the women power led by mass immigration such as Ibn Mahdiya, you mentioned that the quota in UPCIM, I think they published a couple of books and then they had a couple of discussions in many sometimes and school too. But at the same time, I know that this idea has been resisted by then from also Patrick called that the conservative group in Indonesia on the 4th of November, you see a lot of women participating in the rally. So what do you think of this kind of competing response to the
government in Indonesia? Thanks, Rory. But can I just, before I start that answering your question, I would like to add some comments Agus mentioned about the percentage of Indonesian Muslims supporting Sharia. I think it's, we need also to look the survey. The survey itself conducted quite a long time ago, it's 2003. But the survey said that when asked whether you agree Indonesia become Islamic state or supporting Sharia, yes, almost 80% of the respondents say yes. But when you break down the questions into, do you agree that thief must be, that we have to, Indonesia should then introduce cutting hands for thief? Almost the same amount, the percentage say no. And do you agree? So that's a lot of element within, before we, you know, we come to a conclusion that Indonesian, majority of Indonesian Muslim wants Indonesia to be based on Sharia, so that's yeah, because you know, the concept of Sharia is broad. Yeah, exactly.
All the people
So yes, back to your question. So what happened? Because yes, if we're talking about women empowerment, there are also strong resistance within the Muslim community itself, including, for example, in Aceh. I can mention Aceh because that's where largely my research is based on. When they were asked, like, do you believe that women should have equal opportunity to work in public? And of course, they say yes. But then they said, but we can just work outside the house. We also need to be responsible for the husband and also for the children. So the idea of motherhood is really strong, and it is strongly their Islamic understanding, the way they understand the Islamic teaching, because being a woman is not just sexually being a woman, but biologically a woman, but they also have that role, you know, being the mother, being the housewives, and also being the wife of the husband. So it is, of course, different when we're talking in the Western context, being, you know, working outside the home. That means being responsible for also, you know, providing child care and everything else. So, yes, of course, in the last 2-3 rallies, we also see lots of women marching with, you know, a group of men led by Habib Rizik. And for me, it was like, do they understand what this man is, you know, promoting? Because exactly the same people who also work at the local level, trying to impose the Islamic Sharia base, you know, the Perda Sharia, are the people who are basically conservative and trying to impose their conservative interpretation of Islam. And these women marching with them. So for me, as a researcher, it's a big question that, you know, I would like to talk to them. What happened is also, this is again another sign of how the conservatives have been, you know, successful in promoting their agenda by saying, for example, if you look at the social media, now trying to attack women who are working, you know, by, you know, saying like, oh, women should not work it, because, you know, what happened now with LGBT, this is because men, because women are not at home. Women do not cook for their children, for their daughters. So that's why, you know, because of unhealthy food, and that's affect their biological, you know, sexual orientation. You know, you can imagine how, you know, this is like, but that's how the conservative works. And it works. And it works in a society like in Indonesia, where there are a lot, there's a very strong social conservative Asian. And then again, this is being used by the conservative, like Habib Rizik, and also other groups like Hizbut Tahrir, and even among within Muhammadiyah, or I believe there are also a lot of, you know, conservative ideas that, you know, try to work out with the society and try to really win.
And
is there any way how we deal with it? Yes, of course. You know, is talking about it publicly, and, you know, trying to really spot the weakness in the way that they're thinking about the role of women in society. That's also something that we have to work out. And of course, sometimes I think this is why, say, the idea of Majlis Taklim, for example, to be revitalized. Because the Majlis Taklim is very much Suharto and very much New Order kind of thing. But I think that's what happened during the New Order period. The NU and Muhammadiyah were able to use this space. Space are being taken away and then captured by the conservative. And that's what I talked with my colleague, for example. We need to really take back that space from the conservative, and then, you know, really try to engage rather than going away. So, because, for example, people like me, I sometimes blame myself for not being actively engaged with this, you know, with these people, you know, and sort of like, okay, you know, no, I don't care what's going to happen, what happened. I think that's what moderate people and progressive Indonesian Muslims should be really look at this issue seriously.
Okay, thanks, Rina. So, coming to your last point that you mentioned, Patrick. I'm just, you mentioned earlier about one of the key
in the movie we saw also that there are a couple of different families. We saw one family, I think years ago, I think. So there are two girls of the family that we cannot just and we know that you now exposed with many different information, they can access interaction from as for mine, as Master Du said earlier. So how do we deal with them? With the youth and they expose with everything of the thing, and then it's unfine.
Well, we have two concerns which are separate but they're related. One is we have a concern about extremist ideas and behavior which undermines principles of Panchasila and respect and tolerance. And that's a big concern. That was the concern on the 2nd of December, Friday, a week ago, and on the 4th of November. That it was an attempt, it should be said, probably a lot of the initiatives coming from elite political players for their own reasons. We shouldn't think these things are always about religious sentiment. When Donald Trump said that he wants to stand up for the workers of America, actually, he was trying to get elected as president. Whether he actually delivers for the workers of America is another question. Populism is very opportunistic in sentiment. In cases, it is local reactionary forces, sometimes PKS or others, but actually you can't blame PKS. Kurdish Sharia mostly is implemented by secular politicians who are trying to get popularity. Always a danger. The trouble is they are playing with fire, and that use of religion for sectarian purposes can lead to very bad consequences. Of course, one of the more intense kinds of fire that can come out is when people actually go so far as joining ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra or Jamaat Islamia, and to turn the violence either within Indonesia or outside Indonesia. To correct that, well, the social networks, beginning with the family, are very important. A lot of youth who end up being drawn away. Their relationship with their father is broken down, or is an absent father. That's a big factor. Kids from healthy families too can be victims, so I'm not saying it's so simple. Some kids have the misfortune of growing up in very extremist environments. But bear in mind, if you ask around with friends and you observe an extremist family and manage to survive and go beyond that and find a place where they escape extremism, through other broader families, broader friendship circles. And we can work very actively to try and create healthy environments, healthy social networks. I don't think we should be excessively afraid of the internet or social media. It's not the problem in itself. But it becomes a problem when it draws people into unhealthy relationships. So, of course, some practical common sense rules apply with children, about unsupervised internet access, which is hard, but involves a smartphone. But to try and put them less in harm's way. But at the end of the day, it's not the technology, it's the looking for friendship through technology which leads them into trouble. So if we give them healthy friendship and healthy family, then they're less vulnerable. And thankfully, with Muhammadiyah and Mu, most of that happens. Mostly it's a very good thing, which is why I think the number of groups of terrorism is low. But just in conclusion on this point, if we can take polling to mean anything, there has been polling about attitudes towards Magara Islam to Sharia. Of course, Sharia is a positive concept, so in a sense, it's unfair to ask people about who supports. Everyone wants to support Sharia. The question is, how do you apply Sharia? Gusto believed in Sharia. Gusto's feminism was based on Sharia. Gusto's democracy was based on Sharia. But of course, his understanding of Sharia, if you listen to him, was broad and based on a deep Islamic understanding, not a narrow understanding. So there have been surveys that ask the questions more narrowly. Do you support punishments, for example? And I remember one survey done by PPEM, back in 2007, very frightening results. And results over the last decade suggest that there's a level of on this spectrum between sort of progressives, moderates, sort of mainstream and reactionaries. There is a worrying number of people drawn to reaction and radicalism. This year, Pew asked people around the world, do you support ISIS? In Syria, 22% said yes. But in Syria, of course, they're under fire. You can understand the situation. In Nigeria, 14% said yes. In Malaysia, 11% said yes, which is very worrying. In Indonesia, it's only 4%, which is good, except 4% of 265 million people. There's a vulnerability there. And I guess the conclusion we take from this is that we live in open democracy here in Australia, but in Indonesia. And open democracy means there's a contestation of ideas. We can't give up. We have to keep on campaigning and working. We can't, for example, allow reactionary politicians, Paul Enhanced in One Nation or something, Liberal Party, like Cory Bernardi in Australia, to push Islamophobic ideas. In America, they have to campaign against Donald Trump. Yes, make him a good president, but also don't get into the ideas list. Things are undermined. In Indonesia, there needs to be constant work. Otherwise, the small element of extremists will have more and more control over time, and we will lose that. So it's a constant work. Part of that constant work is putting social networks, disseminating good ideas. One of the elements, as a kind of barometer, but also as a practical element, is people's attitude to questions of difference, including gender. And somebody who is truly progressive and even truly moderate will be respectful of difference, and they will be a feminist, because otherwise it's not consistent with those ideas. But to influence the majority, we have to work in creative ways and in a constant basis, which is part of what we're trying to do here.
Okay, thanks for addressing the questions. So I think to join my kind of question for all the panelists, and then after that, give open some questions for all the participants. So coming back to Masan, you mentioned that we have a lot of problems with the education, not only the curriculum, but also the stakeholders, and then many more. You mentioned also that the answer provides access for the internet so I'm just wondering whether the idea of that police school that has been issued by a couple of could be one kind of dealing with this kind of supervising students to access the
So if the school test school, the question is full test school the answer? Because the Ministry of Education and Government of Indonesia always fail to identify the core problem of Indonesian education. We need to recognize that we need a radical change of the Indonesian education, like the basic question of Indonesian education. The basic purpose of Indonesian education is not to transmit the knowledge, but to educate. And that's based on the policies known as assisting us. But the reality, education more is transmitting the knowledge. But actually, this coming week, last week, I'm a little bit happy with the change of national education, of national examination, but apparently last week doesn't want the national examination to be canceled because he's like his thinking is like businessman, right? Talking to Indonesia, the education in Indonesia without having an exam, so we like that kind of thing is like typical of businessman thinking, right? Problem with the national education, right? It created a rigid system and the academic culture of Indonesian school being very rigid, all the teaching and learning are to be answering the worksheet, student worksheet, something like that. So there is no like active teaching being involved into this. So that's what we need to change in the Indonesian education system. And talking about internet, I supervise internet access. The problem of young internet users in Indonesia is that they have difference between in school internet access and then out of school. like all of the studies they are like that out of school. Indonesia teacher cannot teach how to use internet in a good way. So that's a big problem. You know, they critical in the internet content, critical media, you know, internet literacy, something like that is in all of these businesses.
Okay, so the point is that the message to the internet is not to educate, but only transmit the important thing. Okay. Thanks, Mas Agus. So for Badina. So earlier this morning, Pak Asif mentioned that the problem is that Indonesia at the moment is in the middle of the battle between the idea of liberalism in every aspect and the idea of like radicalism in every aspect. And one of the issues with the World Economy in Indonesia that is recognized by the NGO and the organization is that this is only job. And then I'm just wondering whether there is any way to mitigate the tensions. Why is it individual and what kind of empowerment that we should do? I mean, to apply by being fully low and then practical method at now.
I will answer that based on my research on Indonesian on female students in pesantren and State Islamic University. For audience who are not familiar, State Islamic University is the government funded university for Islamic studies. And so, in my research, was trying to find answer of why. Families, parents, send their children to further their study in higher education to Islamic school, so Islamic university rather than to public schools, public university. And I was talking with the parents and also talking with the female students themselves, not just those who are graduated from secular schools, but also from pesantren or madrasa, the Islamic. And these female students said that for them, getting higher education is a form of moderation. And some of the female students graduated from madrasa at pesantren, for them, going to state Islamic universities means that they can share rooms with their male friends, with their male students, because pesantren students, female and male, have to go to different classes. And it's liberation, and it's a good thing because they know why was that when they were in the center, they were not allowed to be in the same room with men, with male, with boys. And so for them, basically in my research, we conclude that education is the most important for community, not just male and female, but all of us, so that they know what being modern is. I don't want to talk about westernization, but being modern means that they then can engage with the discussion, with the debate, and this is something that they've never learned before, they've never experienced when they were at also secular schools. And it was in state Islamic institution that they were able to experience and have an exposure towards this sort of environment. So in a way, through education, they can also learn what it is being Indonesian versus being Western. And so I think in the end, we conclude that these Indonesian female students said that being a female, being Muslim, being Indonesian doesn't mean that they cannot do other female students in different part of the world can do. They can also learn Korean, they going traveling abroad and you know everything else. So that's also something that I think we need to look at too.
So for Patrick, I think the two or three last problems, I saw that the rule of formats at the end of media, it seems quite confusing. Some of them are wrong against colleagues, but the others are but we know that Islam is much more than half issue. There is something more than that. More of this issue and the rule of the format to prevent the radicalization of the youth. The next coming years in Indonesia, because I know that there will be more rally forward than versus power.
Yeah, we live in around the world, but also including Indonesia. We live in an age of anxiety and contestation of ideas across. Sometimes because they really believe in those ideas, sometimes because they're just trying to win political office. But those things come together. And we certainly that means we live in an age of populism. Populism is politics where you campaign just to sort of sentiments, sort of emotional people feel about. In America, the average middle class person hasn't seen a wage increase in decades and likely now to end up doing better than their parents than was the case of generation ago. So there's substance to that. In terms of what role OMAS plays, in Indonesia, it's always a case of whether we see what's been achieved and be grateful for what's been achieved, or we see what is lacking, you know, whether the glass is half full or half empty, right? So in education, for example, one of the real successes has been with Pesantren. Most Pesantren have Madrasa Dinia and Madrasa Aliyah. And the Madrasa Aliyah is very positive because you're teaching state curriculum. It's those Pesantren or Madrasa that don't have Madrasa Aliyah that sometimes become used by extremism, and even then it's the extracurricular activity. Of course, just because you have Madrasa Aliyah doesn't mean that everything is good. There's still a lot of catch up to do. As far as education goes, and this relates to OMAS because Muhammadiyah and Inu are very much linked to education. Education that not just gives knowledge and broad knowledge. Madrasa Aliyah is good because it's good that Pesantren students learn not just about religion but also about science and maths and language. So, okay, the knowledge is important. And then critical thinking. So we can really learn how to be discerning. And contribute more to society. In the age of internet and social media, I believe that means we should teach access to the social media in the school, whether here or in Indonesia, and teach kids to think critically about, okay, what's going on? I mean, for example, if you watch the ABC program, Rural and Planet, right? They teach us how to understand advertising. What are the advertisers trying to do? And kids are very quick to learn. They say, okay, that guy is trying to sell me sweet breakfast cereal to make money, but I know that's not healthy. And you learn critical thinking. We do the same thing in our schools. So we need to do more work. Indonesia has yet to catch up with the critical thinking side. Some progress, but still more work to go. Thirdly, education is not just about knowledge and critical thinking. It's also about values that we teach, but also partly things that we model by the relationship with teachers and students and amongst students. And there's a lot more work done in Indonesia on that. So Muhammadiyah and Nehru can contribute a lot more in that space. I believe Indonesia would be very much worse off without the war master of Muhammadiyah and Nehru and other large groups. I think it's generally a good thing. But they're not perfect. So sometimes people in these groups are thinking of political careers. They do things not out of conviction but out of opportunity. Sometimes their thinking is very backward or even reactionary. We need to work on something like the AHOC case. Is to help people understand what's really going on. You don't have to vote for AHOC, it's your personal choice. Democracy means you make a choice. But please understand what the real facts of the matter are, what's really going on. Pay attention. Who's trying to influence you and what they're trying to get from you. Let me conclude on a positive note, because I still think it's there's a lot to be grateful for in Indonesia. If you look in the macro, the long term and at a global level, you know, one of the news stories this week is that in the face of intimidation church services, Enru and Bangsa have said they aren't sort of come out and protect churches as they've done in past Christmases. This is a good thing. I mean, we need more of this, but it's a good thing, basically. It's a practical measure. I think the more that we can encourage our young people to mix with each other, mix with each other, those Anak Bangsa who go to the church service, protect the church service with their Christian friends, respect their friends and the difference, automatically they see that, you know, a strong faith is not going to be challenged by a Christmas tree or by carols. You know, it can withstand difference. It's not going to faith. It'll actually make your faith stronger because you come to appreciate your own faith better through respecting others. And I think there's more good things happening than bad things happening in Indonesia, but it's in the middle of a time of great contestation, which means that this next generation needs to be playing a role, and hopefully some of you will become politicians. Principal politicians, not bad politicians, or at least be active in LSM, in civil society, even beginning here in living in Melbourne. There's a lot for us to be working towards. There's a lot at stake. Well, I think so. I think that when Gusto was saying he was going to be president, people laughed at him, including me. It turns out he was right. And I think we should be encouraging young people, you know, girls as well as boys, to think about the possibility of becoming president in the future. At least Indonesia's already had one woman president, so that would be. But the level of women in parliament is still quite small, and there's a lot more work to be done. That's where the Ormas, by the way, can make a big difference. One of the reasons that Indonesia made that democratic transition was not just this large civil society of the Ormas, but inside Muhammadiyah, inside Enru, democracy for many years. At the Muktama, there's voting. So they were kind of prepared, they were educated to look at women's participation, women's leadership. So that's modern, that's further developed, because that will then have impact on the broader society. And this will all help lessen the influence of extremism.
Okay, thanks, Patrick. Now I'm going to open positions for questions or comments. So two men identify it. Okay, one more. Okay, so four first questions.
Just want to make a comment. I used to teach in Madrasa in 1994, many years ago. So I'm quite familiar with the curriculum in there. I'm not sure it may change, but back too many years ago, it is 13 units has been teach in Madrasa. So, it's mostly similar to the book. Yeah? And just they add up something like ilmu hadith, how to understand the hadith, fikih, how to do salat, and so on. And it's just quite safe for our kids as well. And from my point of view, it's not about the school curriculum. I know if you're talking about the curriculum, we have dichotomy actually, especially for Madrasa, because it's under MORA, yeah? Ministry of Religious Affairs and Trade School, under the Department of Education. So, but how people recruit the youth is more, it's not in the extracurricular of school curriculum. It's more in the informal education, where people attend a small pengajian called halako, and then this is like instead of like they say, this is like false friend or it is like try to recruit them, and so many logical fallacies going around. in social media. It's like saying, oh, Professor this one from Melbourne Uni saying this, and supporting the rally. I said, all people. I said, there's many of it. And also, this is a comment for Baba. And also, for empowering Muslim women, if we looking back for what happens in subway London bombing 2005, or when someone in a suicide bomber, who's the Indian prime minister a long time ago, one of the women in the London bombing was educated woman. Oppressed. Another one, I can't remember, China was a high educated woman. A woman like her still involved in radicalism, in the radical action. Is it? Can we guarantee that education for women will defend community from the radical action situation? Thank you.
It's kind of similar to what Ibuyanti mentioned. It's basically quite sad that there are so many honest and kind people are being manipulated and isolated because they are middle class family and they are like they are not wearing hijab, but the way they're thinking they're quite conservative. Often they go to pengajian, and then the ustaz are quite conservative too, and they just accept what the ustaz say. And they didn't want to actually argue what they say. And then what happened to the children? Because if we watch the movie from Jihad Selfie, the parents may help the children not to go to the violent extremism. But if the parents have that kind of thinking, that kind of conservatism, right? And then, and how do the society actually try to stop this movement? Because it's not just in the villages, but I come from Jakarta, I come from Pekanbaru, and then there's so many people already have that kind of thought of conservatism.
So, although they are not
wearing hijab. So that's basically,
yeah, moving on. This question for Greg or for...
Yes.
Okay. Next, Mas.
Yeah, thank you very much. My name is Adila. Islam in Indonesia is not only a religion, it's part of culture and identity, and I'm gonna ask from like a teacher's perspective. So, how is the appropriate way? I mean, I am from Pesantren, and I'm sorry if I'm like a little bit judgmental about this, but sometimes if we like incorporate Islamic values and Islamic teachings into education, somehow it is sometimes like viewed as the extremism or radicalism. So, I think my question is how is an appropriate way to incorporate teachings and Islamic values into education without being viewed as extremism or radicalism? Like a single-sex school is like viewed as a radicalism. Mine is also a single-sex school, and then it's just a single-sex school because it's like to like avoid like free sex or something like that, and that is extremist. But I'm afraid that it's like viewed as an extremist or radicalist. So, again, as a future teacher, how should I teach my students Islamic values without being viewed as extremist? Thank you.
Thanks, Mas Adila. I think this question for the session is from.
Ibu Elena, bahasa Indonesia.
Wolf, Greg, just wondering about young people being drawn to extremism with problems with family, absent father figure, etc. You said we need to work to create healthy environments. I was just wondering if you could expand on that a bit more, even in the Indonesian context, and also if you can explain a little bit more about age of anxiety and contestation, what that actually means.
Thanks.
I mean,
it's very common in Indonesian. Some questions that are specific for Mas Agus, some are specific for Ibu Dina and so I think we start from I think two or three questions.
All right, thank you so much for the question. So so the way I look at how extremism is spread in terms of Indonesian education, it could be inside and outside. Like I mentioned before, it could be inside and outside. I teach for solar support, super pressure, and then I try to force my students not to use Quran. I think that kind of thing shouldn't exist in the education. Like the good teacher will let the student choose which one, like having kunot or having not kunot, something like that. And then like the first thing when I was participating in the first group discussion about the Islamic education in the US, like there is interesting story about student in Islamic school in the US. It is okay to have a dog at home. Like, this is very interesting question. And then there are a lot of people about this because as you know, that some Muslim are allowed to have a belief that having a dog is okay, and that some of them are okay. How as a teacher we decide on this? Just up to the family, right? So we need to spread this kind of thing in the Indonesian education. Like in the Indonesian education, like for example, there is an increasing of Islamism. Like in the public university, it's a program of having scholarship. It is okay if it is in the Islamic university, like it's UIN or fine, but in public university, it shouldn't happen, in my opinion. Because, you know, public university is not religious, something like that. And it is true, like socialization, like there are a lot of paper increasing of extremism in the Rohis, like Rohis activity, something like that. You can Google it. Okay. And then the next question, and then how we as a teacher, I think, like Hasan mentioned before, we need to develop the hybrid Islam, not Islam in Indonesia, right? That's the different thing. Like a lot of people tend to export, tend to infuse the Arab Islam into Indonesian education. And that I answered before. And a good thing in Islamic education in the US, they also try to campaign Islam in the US, American Muslim, develop American Muslim identity, right? Like trying to teach a student to visit the synagogue, right? Something like that. We can develop that kind of thing too. Like I mentioned before, like visiting the church will not cover it, you know? Like, Indonesian education needs to develop hybrid identity of Indonesian Muslim or Islam. I think that's the question. Like by having, you know, allowing, like for example, reason Bupati of Purwakarta is very good. Bupati Dedi allowing just to build the community center in the school, that kind of thing, I think is good. I think that's
okay. Thanks, Pasagus. Okay, but Tina.
I think I can sum up from all the questions. One thing is that Indonesia is not an Islamic country, and we are a secular. Indonesia is a secular nation, and I recently wrote a piece for Al Jazeera. That's exactly my argument. Now is that I think to get that idea of what Indonesia is, that it is a secular state, it is a secular nation. And of course, I'm reading Pak Greg's book again when I was invited to come to this event. And it's always been there, the discussion of where should the idea of Islam or where should Muslims' aspirations channel when Indonesia become a state, become a modern state. So the discussion prior to our independence, and it continues until now. But in fact, we already get the answer with the, and this is what most of us forget about, that we have constitution, it's very clear in the constitution what is big Indonesia means. So the question of what, as a teacher, what should I teach in schools for my, that's it, that Indonesia is a secular state, you know, Indonesia have a constitution, and everything should be based on the constitution. Are going to make democracy works, it has to be based on the constitution. This is an example when we moved, I finished my PhD from Melbourne Uni in 2010. We moved back to Indonesia. My son was in year five, and he spent year one to year five in Brunswick, so West Brunswick Primary School. And I remember in year one, he was asked by the teacher to bring the seeds from Woolies, and then he put it with his friends on the soil, and then from there, you know, after a week, there's a plant. And so when we went back to Indonesia in year five, in class, and I didn't send them to Islamic school. It's a public school, it's a secular school. Science class, he went back home saying, "Mom, my teacher said I was wrong when she asked me who creates plant." And he and my, what was your answer? And he answered, he said, my answer is like, it's from seed. And the teacher's son said, no, you're wrong. It's from God. So this is something that, you know, this is education, this is educational institution, the government, even though you are not funded by the government. Right? And we are a secular, can't be mixing religious teaching with, you know, with science. Yeah, so it creates confusion. And so that's just one example. I believe there are lots of other examples. And for me, again, this is the problem also we have. I'm quite happy when Pak Greg said Indonesia is still very promising in terms of democracy, but we just listened to what Ibu said, you know, I guess her voice is, you know, the voices of the majority of modern progressive Indonesians at the moment who are worried with the future of Indonesia. This is also what happened in educational institutions, because more and more of subjects based on their individual understanding of their own values, in this case, Islam. Of course, this is also problems for scholars working on Indonesians and trying to understand the Islam politics and everything else, because even for politicians, they couldn't really quite make a clear separation of, you know, being Muslim and being the representation of the community. You know, people who voted for them are not just entirely Muslims, but there are also, you know, people of different faith. But when they are in about this, and so I would like to also relate to the last point Padre mentioned about women's involvement. Yes, we have seen an increase in the representation of women in parliament from only 9% during Suharto to 18%. But if you look at the policies of what these women's in parliament produce, because the voices that they represent is the voices of the conservative. Why? Because that's the populist voices, the popular voices. They don't want to go against that popular voices. So there are lots of work need to be done, of course. And that's why civil society organizations have been working with these women who are members of parliament, you know, trying to really engage what do they understand about women's rights, about equality and all this thing. Because, for example, three women recently elected as the vice governor, as mayor in East Java, and if you look at their policy, none of them are pro-women. And when you look at, you know, why, that's because they are building coalitions with the members of the community. And because, as I said, they are trying to buy the popular opinion of, you know, in regards to women, you know, because women's morality is the problem of the social problem in Indonesia. It all comes from women, because women are not good, so that's why we are going to be bad nation, something like that. And of course, those sort of propaganda works well and receive well in the society. So, yeah.
Thanks, Gina. I think there are two questions that are specific for Patrick, but I think you can comment on other questions because I think it's quite the same issue of even radicalisms and radicalisms. And you can comment on.
Okay, well, I think a lot of the discussion we've been having, because it's focused on youth, is about education. So let me go back to the points I was making earlier just to summarize. Education, for it to be healthy and positive in every sense, including taking people in a good direction away from extremism, needs to have three elements and a fourth element in terms of the way it's fit. So the three elements are, education is about knowledge. It is about imparting knowledge. It's a good thing. If you're trying to learn your times tables, you know, if you don't want to rely upon using your phone to multiply things, you need to learn that. And rote knowledge is very important. If your son or daughter is learning, they probably need to spend a lot of time learning characters. That's rote knowledge. So rote learning has its place. And knowledge in general has its place. And I want to reflect on where religion fits in this. It's not a problem in the appropriate place to have content that relates to religion. So, in a Muhammadiyah madrasa, basically madrasa aliyah, or Emu Pasantra madrasa aliyah, there's some reflection on religious content. One of the problems we're facing in this moment age of anxiety is religious sentiment that's effectively fundamentalism. Well, there's a few distinguishing aspects about fundamentalism. One is it makes the claim of going back to the original source of truth. Back to the Bible, back to the first generation, back to the apostles, back to the Asali. But it's kind of a false claim because the other thing that fundamentalists do is they ignore centuries and centuries of religious scholarship. So they throw it away and say, anymore. I mean, you hear the Islamist extremists. How many classical scholars do they quote? The only classical scholar that gets quoted is Ibn Taymiyyah. And only then because he says some things particularly about the Mongols coming to Baghdad. So they don't quote all the other classical scholars. Only they quote Ibn Taymiyyah out of place. Even he that don't understand properly. So they're throwing away centuries and centuries of scholarship. Same thing, you know, if you're talking about fundamentalist Christians in Australia or America, they forget all of that same things of theological reflection and learning. So if we have education that imparts knowledge, but in a good way, that's a first element. Why very few kids who are Ulusanta Santra from Nimbu Santra ever become terrorists is because that environment tends to impart sound knowledge. There's a connection with the Ulama and the traditional knowledge, which is very important, because one thing you learn, whether it's Christianity or Buddhism or Hinduism or Judaism or Islam, centuries of religious scholarship teach us that there's no black and white answers. There's absolute truth, but absolute truth is always mediated through human beings, and it's subject to error and mistake, and there's disagreement amongst scholars. Two leading scholars can have different opinions on certain things, and so if they're wise, then they learn to understand that only I'm wrong and he's right, or vice versa. And that comes through in their scholarship. It's nuanced, it's subtle, it's open. It needs to come through in education. It's thinking, critical thinking. In knowledge content, it has to be about thinking, how you think critically about issues. Whether it's the internet, whether it's reading a newspaper, whether it's watching television, whether it's somebody making a statement claiming about religious content, but actually just because they say something is the way it is, it may not be so simple. Somebody might say, so-and-so blasphemy. Okay, what do we mean by that? What did they actually say? What was the intention? How do we, let's think critically about what's being said, not just take this thing without context. Third intellectual aspect is wisdom. Wisdom is about knowledge and it's about thinking, but it's also about values. Very smart, but not wise. One person might get high grades and make a lot of money, but lack any moral compass, lack any moral depth. Somebody who is wise understands the true meaning of things. You know, as the joke goes of certain professions, a lawyer or an accountant, they can tell you the value of anything, but the meaning of nothing. They don't know what the real meaning of something is, but the real moral content, the real deep spiritual content. I think one of the things that has blessed Indonesia and Islam, if you can use that expression, which we haven't mentioned yet, Pancasila and Undang Undang, so Mapul Lima, is the contribution of the Sahabs, of Sufism. Now, it doesn't have to be that you agree with, for example, making Sakara, go visiting. Of course, the Muhammadiyah don't believe in that, right? You don't have to make the ziyarat before. If you're talking to her, then lots of stories about ziyarat before. I asked him what his hobby was when he was studying in Baghdad. He was in Baghdad 3 years. Is he my hobby? Of course, my favorite hobby, apart from eating, is ziyarat. Because he's living in a very ancient historical land, lots of kubur. So his sort of bucket list was to go around with different kubur all over Iraq and beyond. But of course, in Muhammadiyah, you wouldn't do like that. But it doesn't mean that the teaching of tasawwuf is lacking in Muhammadiyah. The idea of tasawwuf, as we know, has parallels in other religious traditions. Christianity, for example, the Sermon on the Mount has this element, is to think about intention and motivation, what's going on in somebody's heart, as opposed to external legalism. Because external legalism doesn't tell us the whole story. What's really important is kind of a niya, is our intention, as opposed to what we might be seen to be doing. And that very much influences wisdom. And I think that's in healthy presumption or madrasa communities, we see that a lot. And it basically insulates those country from being drawn to extremism. Norhuda's film mentioned a few extreme cases. We had in Laman, one of the Santran. We had Santran that Buddha himself studied at Nuruki, Al-Mukmin and Nuruki in Solo. Those are the exceptions to the rules. Most of Indonesia's 25,000, 30,000 Santran don't follow those sort of examples. They are the exception. Even those Santrans, it was not the formal classroom teaching so much as the extracurricular that was dangerous. The fourth element we need for education is community. Santrans work very well because you have a natural community. It's basically a healthy situation. I'm not saying it's perfect, obviously there are shortfalls, but in a modern urban setting, a good school education is not just about the kids going there in the morning and back in the evening. It's what they do on the weekends. It's what they do lunch break. It's what they do excursions in, you know, after hours. And the sense of respect they have for their teachers and their fellow students. And you know, your son goes to school in Brunswick. Hopefully, he learns to respect people of different religious backgrounds. Many of his classmates are Muslims, some are non-Muslims. That's all part of the subtle process that comes through community and that contributes to healthy education. So why do we see smart middle-class intellectuals, let's say middle-class people anyway, adopting extremist ideas? I think there's a couple of things going on. One is often we have a phenomenon in Jakarta, it's very clear, of orang santri baru, you know, people who haven't grown up with much religious knowledge, so they look for it. Now, I remember when Chuck Moore was around and was running Yayasan Palamandina, and what I observed, that fulfilled a very positive role. Would go along to evening classes, hear a lecture, and people who didn't have much religious knowledge found their thirst for religious knowledge way that didn't ask them to give up everything they learned in university or working in the city, but could explain to them how you can be an urban professional. And it was a positive outcome. But unfortunately, there are some people giving lectures where you go along having never grown up in a religious household and not being much religious knowledge. And what you end up taking is something that's very uncritical. It doesn't have, it has limited knowledge, doesn't have that classical scholarship. It has a lack of critical thinking, doesn't have much wisdom. And the community setting tends to be sort of fundamentalist and limiting. So that can affect anyone. We constantly talk for this idea of creating healthy environments. It's understanding that we act as we do as human beings because we are social creatures. All of us are social creatures. We post something on Facebook. When you post on Facebook, what do you want to find happening? Like, if you're posting, it's not liked. It's like very sad because we are driven by a very basic impulse to be liked. Well, it's a legitimate impulse. We want to be part of the community because we don't want to exist by ourselves. We want to be liked because we want to be acknowledged, we want to belong. And if we have that in a healthy way, it protects our young people. If it's absent, then they're vulnerable not just to extremism, but to drugs, to relationships, to abuse. Lots of bad things can happen because they don't have bad friends. Bad friends take them to bad places. I already mentioned that for the most part, you know, mainstream madrasa assumption are doing that. So that's already a good start. That's why India doesn't have a big problem with terrorist recruitment. It's a very small problem. It's a problem, but it's not as big as it could be. Here in Melbourne, most of the kids who got influenced by first Jabhat al-Nusra and ISIS were going to a group in Springdale called the Alpha Khan Center. Basically a rented bookshop. It's a RUCO. Downstairs bookshop, upstairs, cinema hall. Something similar in Sydney, a place called Parasala in Bankstown. And in Brisbane, you have Ikra Bookshop. In all cases, it wasn't mainstream mosque or prayer hall. It was a small fringe of the fringe. And we can be critical because Neil Prakash has just been arrested in Turkey, leaving Syria, sorry, leaving Mosul, Iraq, was influencing many of his friends back in Melbourne. So through social media, encourage them to launch attacks, you know, very negative environment. It'd be very interesting to hear his story. So we can say, well, it's a bit of, I mean, he didn't know his father, his mother suffered from schizophrenia, so he ended up finding friends at Alpha Khan. We can say, what a pity he went to Alpha Khan because it was a malign environment. The lessons, I think, because it was kind of a youth drop-in center. Meet other friends, get religious instruction. It was negative, the influence was negative because the leadership was negative, the teaching was negative. But we can take that example and do something positive. When there was a CPE forum in a summit organized in Sydney, I heard one speaker from East London. He runs a group called London Tigers. And if you don't know much about London Tigers, you think it's just a place where kids drop in and learn how to do boxing. Right? And you think, well, it's just a drop-in center for kids. Actually, this guy is a religious teacher. He's Fatima, and he knowledge, and he's concerned about recruitment to terrorism. But he runs boxing classes through this London Tigers, which is a positive name, because what he recognizes is to give these kids a place to come and hang out, positive role models. He doesn't teach religion during the regular program, but if somebody asks him questions, somebody can sit and talk and say, you know, Robert, have you thought about this? Have you read this? You know what this scholar said? And that was a way of insulating those children, those young people, against being drawn to more extreme elements, which are certainly present in East London. So I think that's an example of the sort of things that we can do, proactive, positive. Some of the better local councils and schools do that. So it's not about reinventing things, it's just about recognizing the value of those things when they are being done and encouraging them. To some kids, it might be going to Girl Guides or Boy Scouts in Australian context. In Indonesia as well, we have basically, they have good friends, good role models, maybe adults, but older young people, and in appropriate ways, by all means, talk about religion, but in a way that respects knowledge, thinking, and wisdom, as well as just sort of simplistic teaching, then it can take them in a good direction. And, you know, actually, most of the times this is working. It's the exception that doesn't work. But the exception is a big exception. And there's some the people who are holding to extremist ideas more hardworking and often more dedicated than we are. And so even though they're a smaller number, they can have a bigger influence. So we have to recognize that and say, well, we better not just be, you know, resting on our laurels. We have to be out there and be active as well.
Okay, I'm going to open up one more sentence, so it'll be the final sentence. So if you have some, I think two women, two men. Which one? What has you just? I think the one you. Yeah, I think yeah. Okay, let's send you both, and then let's have the other one. Okay, so we have people, please, only one question. Okay, one question is enough.
And I was actually stupid. I asked my permission. I was going to ask him the root, how? Because I gather that Andrew and Mahmoudia have said that they would not take part in the post legislations. But Chair Andrew is an endless. So I want to ask Jenny, what does he think about this? Because it looks to me as if it's majority is amongst the country and the minority. And I was wondering if Kusdun is still us, what would he think about this?
Okay, thank you. Maybe just want to make a comment because Patrick said about the rally second, which is a bigger rally that we have seen probably in Indonesia. And it's a draw a lot of concern. One of us, but that concern is very well grounded. But we should also see that I have an opinion in Indonesia actually doesn't have any place. My research is about reservations, but he has that we thought to be like the Islamist party in Indonesia. because they are like advocates Sharia. But along the way, after they integrate into the political system, they become. So this is like the power, I mean, the power of democracy that is implemented in Indonesia means the Islamists become radicalism will not have any place system. What we have seen in the rally, religious movement instead of like radicalism, because if you see the participant, people are subscribed to the idea of radicalism. Most of them are like celebrities, and families with the new age, that's a new age family, who actually want to show this their religious. So it's not, there's nothing, a slight idea of becoming radical. I mean, people like Habib Rizik and Ridwan Nasir from Yumi, he's very radical. But all these participants subscribe to that idea. They just to show their religiosity. So I think that.
Okay, thanks. Maybe back opposite.
Terima kasih Pak dan Audrey. I just want to ask a really simple question actually. What is radicalism? What is extremism? What is intolerance? And what is fundamentalism? Sometimes people always speak about it. I'm just confusing. Because what is right and what is wrong, what the level it is right and what the level that you can, you know. Well, I'm sorry, but I'm not trying to ask you for the really short lecture here last time. Because at the time that we plan to, because words really, really important to us. That's the reason to understand the meaning of the word is really important. The idea. So you come from the idea, and it's kind of resistance. Go through non-violence. Most likely you go through violence, that it's not okay. That's what you're. And the second one, but to empowering women and Islamic school against radicalism, it's come from society or policy. I don't know, because there is a, can I fairly say that like, there is a contestation of realism in our constitution? Liberalism, so it's like rather liberalism. So it's like how did you say this kind of thing? And related to the question on the Bapak sebelumnya said about the Pak Mama, but yeah, about the it's not a moderate, but yeah, the contestant. That's reason about intolerance and something like that. How, yeah, a majority and minority, and some of democracy because they like, gave who has the power of the 40 years to give that kind of thing. So it's like with the people with parliament. So that's the thing. Man. Sorry, but
the power level.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, man.
That's valid. I think we go to.
Thank you. My name is Yanni, and my question is for Adrian Dina. You sort of mentioned that there is a good news and bad news about increasing women representation in our parliament. You say that on a good side, yes, it's a good thing. On the bad side, you see that there that gender equality is still there, in spite of the increasing number. My question would be, what has a women organization like Aisha from Ahmadiyya or Muslimah NU has done to actually help to fulfill that that increasing quota, because we see that the problem with the increasing quota is that the candidates fulfilling the quota are not those who are really capable of bringing up those female specific issues into the policy making, resulting in how policies are still working against women. So what has those organizations has done, and what can be done to actually improve the existing status quo? Thank you.
Next question. The last one? Oh, okay. The last two ones. Okay. Yeah.
Yes, thank you. My name is Mohali. I'm interested with the question posed by, I don't know, brother there, about labeling. Yeah, but because labeling sometimes become like a big deductive formula. I'm interested with what Dr. Adrian said, but because we have to divide also what do you mean by secular? Because you know that religious values is salient. It's a salient window in our country. It's a salient window. We have so many sometimes know that Indonesia struggled for independence. It is the background is many stories they tell that it is come from pesantren. Many pesantren also they struggle for the independence. So I think if we completely say that Indonesia is a secular country, we have to also question about this, because we have to. If we have to contest about theology and public, we have to also clarify which public and which dimension of the public that we mean, which which circle that we have to focus on. The radicalism also, I'm interested about this term, because sometimes it is used with extremism and terrorism. I read an article published by Horgan, one of the experts in terrorism from Pennsylvania State University. He said that radicalism is not linear with terrorism or violence. So if you have a radical faith, it doesn't mean that you will do something violent. You will do something like terrorist act. Like a terror sect. So what we have to focus on now is fight against terrorism, not fight against radicalism. Because sometimes we associate radicalism with the increasing religiosity of someone, the increasing religious values of someone. If we associate radicalism with increasing religious values of someone, people will do a kind of a self-censorship. You know, this is my belief, and then okay, I will not tell you.
Okay, you get the point.
Yeah. Yeah, I think sorry. I'm so sorry. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, I think thank you very much.
Okay, thanks for coming. I think partly because there are some cumulative things to identify, and then issue of radicalism, fundamentalism, extremism.
For Pak Hasim, the Pak Hasim's letter today, so I'm not out. Yeah, the Pak Hasim. Or maybe if some of you want to try to comment on the
Pak Hasim. Yeah. Okay, can we just try and quickly sort of run through the issues? If you know, what would the school do? Was around today, controversial and bound to be newsworthy. Instead of the Galois facade, the big picture way, Gustav was very consistent. So I think on the issue of 4th of November, 2nd of December rallies, he would be very consistent in saying that there was a case, remember, of alleged blasphemy that came when he was president, and he dismissed the case. violation of the prosecutor. That's because he said this is a very dangerous direction to go in, and he acted in a principal way. I think he would say the same thing this time around. The matter don't really fit with his actual definition of blasphemy. I mean, he's in Enugu, close to Kustur. I've been advising our hop for a long time to be careful with the way he expresses things, because words do matter. There is a genuine sense which people feel offended by their understanding of what our hop was saying. But that's not the same as saying that he was blasphemous. So I think that Kustur would be very clear in drawing that line, and very clear in standing up to front of the board. I think what we, you know, we sort of say, well, this Kustur was around us. Were around Chuck Noor and others, a role in the political realm, and he was unique. Not anymore. It's because we want moral leadership and leaders. We want them to stand up to police. We say this is not acceptable. This is a behavior which, with where we come. So he was a genuine progressive leader. It's a very important leader. Some progressives as well, which are boldly, lately. I mean, he's a mixture of progressive and moderate in a complicated way. He wasn't very progressive on that penalty, although he's indicated his open learning. To his credit, he's been frank about that. Lately, he's been more strong. I think part of the issue is that when he was running for president and Prabowo's campaign team ran a black campaign against him, using religion, using his alleged piety or lack of it, he didn't respond to the provocations, and he kept quiet. And I think he thought, I mean, our whole issue should do the same thing, not respond. So you have to show some leadership. So it's important to come out and show a very fine. Lately, we've seen from Barack Obama as president some strong articulation of leadership on issues of extremism. Thankfully, John Howie has begun do that more so. I pray that he has the strength and clarity of mind to. I don't think we can assume that democracy automatically leads inevitably to moderation. It does in general. We're talking here about and dynamics and the general impact. But general impact and general, we can predict the result. If you have a complex system, for example, the weather, trying to forecast what it'll be like next Saturday, it's very hard because it's so complex. There are so many different factors. We know what a high pressure zone does, what a cold front does. We understand all of these things, but how they combine together is unpredictable. So, to AK Party in Turkey as an example of becoming post-Islamist, moving in a more moderate direction. And I think they were correct. AK Party in Turkey went in a, took that group in a positive direction. It's become a dictatorship because of one man, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. His own vanity, his own insecurities, his own ambition, his own ego, country towards dictatorship. Some of the good work of AK Party, people like Abdullah Gül or Davutoğlu in the past have been pushed aside. He's sort of driving the shop himself. So the same thing could happen in a different circumstance. So much depends on leadership. So far, I do agree it's going in a good direction. The fact that we didn't see a PKS element in the 2nd of December is a sign of maturity. So that's a good thing. So democracy generally does moderate. So automatically, I think there's a chance that Donald Trump will become a more moderate president than his campaign suggested. He's not doing it by himself. He has to be held to account by civil society in the process. So it has to be an ongoing process. It brings us though to the question of Holden's question of extremism, where do we draw the line? The boundary line really has to do with it's not about holding strong ideas, it's about how we articulate our responsibility. Do we respect other people? Do we allow them to have their ideas? It's separate from our ideas. I can believe as a Protestant Christian that the Catholics are wrong. The Catholic friend can believe that I'm wrong. As Mohammedia follower, you can say that Ziara is wrong. You guys are wrong, so I understand. But it's a question of how you, people have their own comfort zone.
the Protestant Ecumenical Council and the Protestant Church of Ecumenical Churches seems power and movement and strange incense and things that I'm not used to, right? But that's personal, right? Like my taste in music, I mean, it's one right or one wrong. It's what you get used to, what you grow up with. I mean, your youthful experience shapes these things a lot. It's entirely appropriate you have your own taste and your own preferences. Those of other people. Automatically, a question of what's right and what's wrong. I think on the day of judgment, we'll be asked, in my opinion, how we've behaved and how we've responded to opportunity. People. The scope for diversity of responses there, it's a question of whether we, you know, lived in a principled way according to our convictions. So I think what we need from leadership, whether it's in Australia or America, Europe or in Indonesia, is the point of saying that if you are inciting hatred, libertarianism, as the Dutch prosecutors found this week of Geert Wilders, he was wrong to play to crowd sentiments to say, you don't want Muslim migration, okay, we'll fix it. That was the wrong thing for a political leader to do. It was prosecuted for doing that. I mean, it's easy to mention Habib Prusik because he stands out, he wants attention. Okay, but people like that. If they are calling for hatred or even just for inciting sectarianism, they need to be criticized in the process of law, if necessary, taken to the courts. It's not you can't have strong ideas and your own convictions. You respect other people and you have an incitement for hatred or even just pushing a sectarian communalist view. The old Sarah principle had some truth in it, although it was misapplied in the Sarah era. It means that there is a boundary. It's not even just about violence. Of course, if somebody has a radical ideas, violent extremism, we heard reminded us that most radicals don't go on to violent extremism. And that's a very important thing to understand. Fundamentalist or even politically fundamentalist doesn't automatically mean you end up being a terrorist. But there is a place for saying behavior if it leads to other people engaging in violence or promotes, it tears down the structure of society, social cohesion by promoting sectarianism or hatred, then that should be something that is the subject for intervention. Excessively in the Suharto era, there was too much cracking down on radicals. You have to get it right in the era of democracy. The guide in this sense in the Indonesian context is Pancasila and the Constitution of 45 formulation. We use the shorthand of secular and secularity. Of course, this means a shorthand, you need to break it down. Secularism doesn't mean that religion plays no place. Secular societies have room for religion in their sphere. So somebody can write to the Prime Minister and say something critical about the Prime Minister and his government's response to refugees, for example. Pastor as a priest, as a sheikh, there's a place for doing that. So secular society doesn't mean that religious people disappear. But it does mean that you need to distinguish your own convictions from the way in which the state forms a legal response. I mean, you may be uncomfortable with certain things, certain relationships, personal convictions, and your own personal comfort from what state should do. And the principal position is the state should rule in a way which isn't giving preference to one's kind of religious understanding or conviction. So Pancasila and principles of Indonesian secularism is kind of like a non-sectarian theism. Now, okay, as it was formulated historically, Pancasila has a problem for people who are not theists, but that has been adjusted to scholarship and recent leadership. Saying if you, as an Indonesian citizen, contribute to the greater good, respects general principles, it's what the Americans call civil religion, actually. As to whether you believe in Ziara or not in Ziara, as to your position on which religious community you affiliate with, but the state shouldn't be intervening in that matter. That was the lesson that was learned in Europe, in the UK, for example, with the English Puritans and their response, and it resulted in people like to religious warfare, saying the sovereign
the king, later on the parliament, shouldn't decide on matters of religious conviction. That should be left to the individual. So England went through some bloody wars, the whole of Europe went through bloody wars over these issues. The conclusion in the end is it's not the business of the state on these things. That's an individual conscience matter, but the state needs to give space for that, including the public discussion of such ideas. I think one area where this will come out very strongly in public life is on issues of empowerment of women, opportunity, and those general principles. So it's not just a question of women's issues, it's a question of how we define masculinity, it's a question of justice, it's a question of our maturation.
Greg has already covered almost everything.
I think that's it.
Yeah, I think that Patrick has also explained very clearly, and I think I saw him like nodding his head. So that's exactly. I mean, even Pantasila itself, like what Patrick just told us, for the non-theists is not. Then because with the sila pertama, with the first sila, like Ketuhanan Yang Maha Esa, it's very basic. So what happened with traditional religion who are still there in Indonesia? Anyway, I think I probably just try to address one of the questions specifically on what are the women of NU and Muhammadiyah have done in terms of trying to boost women's representation in politics? And it's not what these two women's wing have done, but the problem is the political parties. Because as you may know, the systems still of the political parties. So even though, for example, the ICA and also the NU put names and then give names to political parties, but then political parties have their own systems of recruitment, etc., etc. That's basically the problem. There have been a lot of discussion on this on etc. So you can look at it. But in my opinion, that the problem is with political parties' recruitment system. And that's probably the idea that Bruce Durr came up. Why and who should have the political parties? And also Muhammadiyah also with Amin Rais in 99 as an on-mandat party. That's also, I think, the idea. But look also at what happened with them in terms of promoting women representation. So I guess that's all.
So
I think the last time in terms of education, I think 5 things that is recommended by the professor on conflict and education from the Manchester University, Professor Lynn Davis. So we need 5 things in our world in order to be more peaceful and then to counter this radicalism. And number one is critical scholarship. So we need more political education, something like that. And then we also need critical respect. And we also need critical doubt that our ideas are professional, like what have been talked by Christopher having. The idea of Islam, as Islam, I think it's the right thing that professional. And then the last thing is the critical lightness. I think it's very good. Obviously, that everything doesn't need to be taken very seriously. Like even after terrorism, slightly after that, there is a meaning, some policemen, something like that. And then after the meeting of president, there is President Trump and the Dimas Kanjeng. President Trump is multiplying the votes. So something like that. I think the critical lens in our society played in combating the radicalism. I think that's helpful.
Okay, thanks.
One sort of comment from Audrey. I think I just remember you said what is right, what is wrong is completely, you know, I think most Indonesians now having trouble in really understanding what is going on, because things that he's right, but the other, like, you know, talking with someone else, and then you get, you know, confronted by other things, and then you're confused, totally confused of, you know, what is right and wrong. And so I guess back to the questions, when you ask, like, what is public? I think Patrick also, again, mentioned that meet with other people's interests, that's when it is public. So that's why when you, for example, of course, your Facebook page is your own page, but when you post something, when you say something, you should be, you know, understand that whatever you said will public comment. So that's my opinion. Well, and that means you are agreeing when someone attack you or trying to engage with your opinions. So that's why I think the whole thing with Ahok, for example, and also with the 212 movement, the WhatsApp and the 411, that is the whole thing about how, you know, because we are the majority, because the Indonesian Muslim community thinks for the Indonesian independence, so that rights to say whatever we want. We need to, you know, talk with these people, like, are you serious with this? And, you know, that we, because only because of that, then we should, you know, not respect rule of law. That is something that I think the conversation should be, in my opinion, move to that direction. Like, there is rule of law, the constitutional democracy, and so the conversation should be shaped and framed within that.
Okay, thanks. And okay. The word radical, I mean, we can sort of answer this more specifically. It comes from Latin roots, a lot of English words have Latin and Greek roots. So this is the same root we get, like the fruit vegetable, and it's used for radics. The idea of radical has the idea of going back to the roots. So we think of a radical as somebody who wants to change something from, as it were, the roots to the branches. They want to completely change things. And PKS was at its strength in campaigning. It had a radical agenda because it wanted to change the political system in Indonesia. It did so peacefully, it was non-violent. And it's even backed away from that radical agenda now to a more moderate agenda. But that was the definition of radical, is you want to change things completely. I tell you that the planet would be better off if everyone was vegetarian or even vegan and would have less environmental impact, would be nice to the creatures and everything. A radical change. And that's a radical aspiration. It's a good aspiration, as long as you do it non-violently. You know, maybe in future people become more and more vegetarian and have less and less meat. That would be good. It would be a radical change. But radical doesn't mean that it's wrong. So if you have a teenager who says, I want to be vegetarian to save the planet, apart from what you're going to cook for them for dinner, because that's a youthful impulse, it's idealism. If they decide they want to go and blow up, you know, a farm, to protest for animal rights, then you take them back to protest against violence. It doesn't make any sense. That's the wrong thing to be doing. And groups like PETA in Europe have been involved in arson attacks that have resulted in death. So, you know, there's a borderline that you cross there. Sort of related to radicalism, but it's a little different. We think of extremism as a more negative thing.
But I think it's a question of definitions. I mean, having extreme ideas, are you a moderate? They say, don't call me a moderate because my passions are really deep and strong. I don't want to be called a moderate. I have strong ideas, you know, and young people particularly like strong language. They don't want to be called moderate, they want to be called extreme. You know, it's about sports that are extreme. So extreme by itself doesn't mean anything wrong. Whether you advocate, support violence in that protest, or in that process. Fundamentalism relates primarily to religion, although there are many atheists who are fundamentalists in their attitude, because it's claiming primary knowledge, it's claiming unique access to knowledge. It tends to take a very simplistic approach to source documents, whether Quran and Sunnah, or whether Bible, or whether it's, I don't know, Das Kapital, or whatever it is you're taking, you know, your lead from. Fundamentalism tends to be judgmental. Most fundamentalists are not a threat to society. They go about their own business. Fundamentalism does become violent, becomes very, very dangerous. Whether it's political violence or whether it's a cult that uses, you know, young people's freedom. Another whole story in itself. So some kinds of radicalism and extremism involve fundamentalism, not all kinds. Of course, we're talking about ISIS. It's a classic case of radical extremist fundamentalist. Utopian, but our problem is the violence that goes with it. And the answer to draw the boundary line, what I was saying earlier is I think we have to be careful about trying to outlaw radical or extreme ideas because that becomes very dangerous. Are you trying to be involved in thought crime? No, we don't want to be involved in thought crime. If somebody is articulating their ideas in a way in which is inciting hatred or is inciting sectarianism, we should draw the boundary line there. So whatever were involved on 2-on-2. Whatever their convictions, that's not the problem, their ideas. It's whether they're inciting hatred or sectarianism. That's where I think the state can step in and probably should step in. Example from this week of builders, ideas. But as an elected official, if he says we're going to stop Muslim migration, we'll fix it. The side of that was inciting sectarianism, if not hatred, and he was appropriately judged for that.
Thank you, Patrick. Thank you.
So I will go to summarize our discussions that we had today. We have a lot of things to get, a lot of things to be with, and I think one of the key points that said, the we should have. We might have different opinions, we might dispute other opinions, but the thing is to respect and allow us to say that different opinions. So I think I need to stop now, but before we play for the sessions, I think there are some opinions to be given for all.
Oh!